when she emigrated to the United States from her remote mountain village in southern Italy. Smuggled dried beans across the Atlantic, reportedly in her moudon. A.K.A. underwear. She left behind jewelry from her mother, but brought along the popularity boots. Generations of my family have been eating the homegrown descendants of her illicit contraband every summer since 1963. My father used to hide the fact that he grew up in Calabria. The people of this southernmost region of the Italian boot have long been maligned with negative stereotypes. Capo d'ost, stubborn. Testa dura, hard-headed, dumb. And worse, Terrone, peasant, dirty, of the land, knowing nothing but how to work land, uncultured. But over time, my father cultivated a tremendous, abundant vegetable garden in our suburban backyard. He did not want to be known in America as a Terrone, and he hid his affinity and his attitude. Unfortunately, disavowing his roots left him with an emptiness that somehow got passed down to me, his American-born daughter. I inherited a painful longing for a motherland I had never seen, a way of life I had never really known. When, as an adult, I moved to Connecticut, I signed up for the condo's community garden, hoping to continue the family lagoon tradition. There had been this moment among the bean poles in my aunt's garden the year before, right there in the middle of the mature plants, towering over me, the leaves gently rustling in the late summer breeze. Of my father, my nonnu, and what seemed like unnamed generations of ancestral energy just came alive in the stalks. It moved right through me, and for a brief moment, I did not feel the familiar belonging, but instead, wholeness and connection. I wanted to continue to feel that, so going against my father's original directive, my shabula. The first thing I learned in my foray into gardening is that it is quite arduous to prepare a freshly dug garden plot, especially when the nearby towns, known by the name of soil type, are called Stonyfield Terrace and Rockland Park. The plot was full of rocks to dig the holes for the celery, the tomatoes, the peppers, the zucchini. Of course, these sacred beets. I hacked hard at that stony ground as I labored, a word broke into consciousness. Chop. Then again, chop, chop, chop. So with each strike of the hardened land, chop. Chop means to hole. I didn't even know I had that word buried under the rocky soil of my consciousness. But it sprang up into mind each time I hit the ground. I hadn't heard the word used in decades. Talk about a metaphor. I was both loosening the soil of a garden and loosening the soil of my soul. Letting that inner, authentic calipacella come up and out. Stop. Along with the word came a warm memory of my mother, who used it often when discussing his American journey notes. Just like that, another layer of that old familiar longing just drifted away. As I continued my efforts at stop potting, I encountered rocks and stones of all dimensions, and I piled them to the side. The pile grew into a mound, and a room, and then a wall. Well, looky here, I thought, I have unwittingly built a garden retaining wall, just like my nonno built for his pomodoro beds, and scores of nonnos before him built all along the Italian coast. what's more, I had enjoyed doing it. I began to feel connected, not just to my roots, but to the random little rocky piece of Connecticut. Because I had worked, the land was no longer foreign to me, and I was no longer foreign to myself. I dropped the Pavlovian pants into the earth and rejoiced at having become a proud and joyful Terrone.